So, hey, hey, everybody, and welcome on the stream tonight. We have a Division 6 and 7 playoff match between the Money Picks and Gubba Gaming. That's two teams from the northern countries of Europe. It's Norway against Sweden and the Rare Cup Group B. Let me give you some silly music for the background. Yeah, boy. The reggae time again, we know that. And today, as a specialty, I got a co-caster, and you know him maybe if you watched a stream of mine before. He was there a few weeks ago on one stream. And let me call him. It's the level 13 warlock. He's still level 13. Since weeks, still level 13. So I will call him now. Let me call him. Yes, I have to write that thing. Wait a moment. Where he is. Like this. Hello, hello. Hello. Hello there, and welcome on the stream again. So, say a few words to introduce you. Yes. Yes. And you're still level 13. What happened? Did you not level it within that time? Still level 13. Ah. That's okay. Okay, yes, no problem. Why not? So today we have a match in the Rare Cup Division 6 and 7 between two north countries. Norway is the piggy bank, Money Picks, and Gubba Gaming from Sweden. Do you have any information about these teams? Maybe you can introduce him for a few sentences while I have to post the announcement into the stream channel. So, wait. So, what do I... Mm-hmm. Oh, you are just you had just a disconnect or something? I still yeah, now I hear you again. By the way, can you hear me right now? Yes, can you? Okay, I think my microphone just deactivated itself, and so I was talking something, but nothing came through. So thank you very much. That was huge information. You are really prepared. And yeah, like you said, so Gubba Gaming is already out, right? They lost two matches. They can't proceed to the final stage. They will be staying in the group stage. So that's why they might be show us some silly stuff, or just some nice show. While the piggy bank guys here, those from the Money Picks, they just started their playoffs now. That's their first match, right? So they are still everything in front of them, isn't it? Yes. It is. Yeah, we had this discussion last time, remember? You like that map. I don't, hey, like. By the way, the first map was already banned. They started the map draft, and so the first map banned by Gubba Gaming is Battlefield. So Battlefield, it's out, and then the Money Picks are banning Alterac Pass. I'm so afraid. I'm sorry. It really hurts. Maybe they play Dragonshire, or they ban it now. I don't know. Let's see. What are the next bans coming? Two bans are out. Two more are coming. So we have Battlefield out, Alterac Pass is out, and as well, Garden still globally banned. Blizzard once tried to patch that bug, but didn't work. It's still there. So that's why Garden is still out. It's okay, yeah. It's Alterac and Cursed, right? Yes, I think so. It's more like Alterac because the map is bigger than Spider Queen. The Spider Queen is closer, but yeah, it's some way like the same. On Garden though, you have more camps than on Alterac, so there's more things to do. But the map is kind of weird, it's true. Hey, Mixin, thank you for watching. Mixin just says hello to us. So Towers of Doom is the next ban. It's still very hot here in my room. That's the disadvantage of living in an apartment that has windows to three sides. It gets very hot when the sun is on the window, and sadly the sun is on the window most times of the day. And yeah, it's nice, but for streaming and the light, it's not that cool. So I have to make it dark behind me, and that's heating up. Well, like that. They banned Dragonshire. Oh my god, no. So okay, it's a typical thing. You will host it? Yes, right. We hosted. So why I'm not surprised that Infinite Shrines is one of the maps that we play. But well. So Mike is from Team Gubba Gaming, so picked by the Red. So we will watch the draft in this window, and after that make the big screen. I think last time that we both streamed together. I still have the old overlay, right? Without my silly face. Or was it? Did I already have the face? Yes. So now we have improved, you know? Yes, now you can see me. I hope you don't have nightmares, but yeah, we improved, right? That's nice and here. You can see us again. Maybe one day you have a camera as well. And I can ring that. That doesn't matter. That's okay. We will, you know, there's some interesting lore in horror as well. So Mixin asks me on which team I bet. I really don't know. So I will want to see the draft first before I want to bet. And I'm hoping for some interesting drafts. I want to see like a Mephi, because the Money Picks like to play Mephisto. I would like to see him. And also some nice drafts from Gubba Gaming. And I'm open for whatever will be the result, and I will make a idea of when the draft is there. So I don't have a favorite right now. I see both teams the first time. That's it. Do you know about the teams? So before you did the analysis, did you know something about the teams, Warlock? Ah. Okay. Yeah, let's see what that will be. I hope it will be a nice show. They're from the north of Europe, and I don't know, is it warm there as well? Maybe. They're playing quite early, 19. It's okay. Oh, that's the monkey music again. So I have, you can't hear it, I think, but I have a little bit of, not that loud, but a little bit of reggae music in the background. So, and I, yes. Oh, yes. We need the camera for that. Yes, yes. I would be confused myself as well. But having two cameras and two people dancing to that music would be entertainment. Yes. So there we go. So Shrines is like, I say this all the time, it's like the most picked map of the Competition Heroes launch, and it's why, because it's macro-wise kind of basic. Everybody knows how to play. Four-man rotation is easy to execute. Just one offlaner needed. You come to the team fights. Those are important on the shrine. Of course, you can do something else, the camp timing and push if you can't contest the shrine. But yeah, the map is macro-wise for competitive hordes, I think the most standard map. Or what do you think? Yeah, true. Yeah. He's really good now. Yes. Yeah, but I think they buffed his damage a little bit in sieging damage, and they nerfed the damage of the laser one, of the Arcane Punisher. He is doing less lasers now, I think, a little bit less. So they got a little bit closer together. That's true. Arcane is still the best. Frost Punisher can open up to a nice place if you abuse the slow. Like you said, there's a Deckard ban. We have Kel ban, we have Anoop ban. It's okay. Kel is the horror of Division 7. We know that. Then is the Anoop, hot contested tank machine. And then we have Deckard ban, like you described before. Deckard, we won't see him tonight. And then Arthas ban behind.
Everything what I expected, except for maybe Anubarak, but Anubarak is like a terror for every division. Like, you don't want to play against it when you don't have.
I'm sorry, I have to admit something. I'm so stupid. I didn't have the sound from you in the stream until now. I had to forgot to I'm so sorry. Yes, now
yay.
I did forget to activate the desktop sound coming through, and I'm stupid, all, and that's why they didn't hear all your talking. That's so silly. Thank you, Mixin, for telling it. And hi, Strider. We meet again. Yes. So there's a Mephi pick. That's the Mephi pick we were talking about. So I'm sorry if everybody.
One team, but.
Level 13 Warlock was doing a really nice description of both teams while I was setting up the stream, and I'm so stupid.
Reported to League of Legends.
So Leo pick, Garrosh pick, Joanna pick. Joanna offers a lot of wave clear on this map, which is nice for a tank. Mephi, good for team fights.
I always question Mephi still, like, he's not doing any job better than other mages would do, but Mephisto is often picked for money picks and often banned too, not so often like other picks. But when it gets a good Mephisto, like I always want to say, when there's a character in white hands, it's very, very dangerous.
True. And yeah, if you get the team fights all the time, if you have Mephisto, you want to team fight all the time, you can do terrible damage. But yeah, I agree, he's somehow hard to figure out. Where does he shine? Where doesn't he shine? Isn't there always a better pick than Mephi? Who knows? But a lot of people don't know how to handle the Mephi, and if they don't have a tool to like punish him when he teleports, he can be really a pain in the ass. Oh, and there's Afia. Like you said before, they like to play Afia, and there she is, and comes along with a Lily.
The good thing is about Gubba Gaming now, they are totally in for doing the Inferno Shrines. Like Ophia or AoE damage, Hanzo AoE damage on this Q, level 4 talent, Johanna already the highest damage I think on the Shrine, except for Kel. And on the other side, the Money Picks wants to team fight. They want to get resets for Genji. They want to have this Mephisto going, and with Vega to it, it's an aggressive support against them.
True. Yeah, we have the Genji and the Mephisto that's team fighting all the time. And if they make a good entry on the shrines, that can work. They have some wave clear now from the Rega, because they were missing wave clear from other sides. Mephisto is a little bit awkward for wave clearing. Genji, Garrosh, not that much. Just Liu has a lot of wave clear, and then that's why they choose the Rega to come up for this, lacking wave clear.
Did they pick Diablo solo lane?
Oh, maybe Johanna in solo lane. Oh my god, what is that? Yes, true. I think it's the Johanna solo lane. I saw this a few times before. I don't think Diablo will go solo lane, that would be...
Like, I'm a little bit shocked. I heard about the rumors of Division 7 and Division 6, but this is now what?
No, this is
Diablo solo and Johanna in one game and on one side. This is a special...
Yeah. I saw, I streamed a match of Division 7 team Fat Punisher, and they did a Johanna Muradin combo with Johanna on the offlane. But Diablo and Johanna? I don't know. Maybe Johanna will be the offlaner, yes. So I will turn off the music, this reggae music here, and I swap into the big game. See you soon, guys. So I have to. Wait. Like this, and on now we are looking at the teams. On the left side, we have the Money Picks with Gouka on Genji, Huxley on Rega, Bloy Petunia on Leo, Risa playing Garrosh, and Yveen playing Mephisto. And would you like to introduce the right team?
Of course, we have Gubba Gaming with Erd4 on Lily, with Ifur on Beastin on Ophia, Dukar on the Diablo, and Mike E on the Johanna solo lane.
Yes, Johanna goes bottom solo lane. And bottom top is solo lane, right? But I don't know. Maybe she... I don't know what she want to do. We are the defenders of the Black Wall. That's what Mephisto's saying. So we see the picture of a Q build for Mephi. And yes, we have the Loss of Hope for Johanna. Eager Adventure for Lily. Q build for Hanzo. Diablo goes Feast on Fear.
Like, probably they just want to let wave clear Johanna and then move someone top, or they do the 1-3-1 as they do right now, Sophie on the top side now, and they try to gank Johanna now.
But she is unstoppable, but she will be thrown in a while. Will she be thrown? Yeah, there she is, and now she has to walk out. She's still alive, she should manage, but Lily is there. Two stun stacks for Garrosh, and there his team comes. So, interesting split.
And this was Loss of Hope, just perfectly. This talent is just so strong. 30% of Johanna's max health every 40 seconds. This is perfect for solo lane or get catch Johanna, just activate it and still be alive, and the enemy team cannot stop it.
Yeah, but also the newly buffed D talent for Johanna, also very strong if you have a healer on your side all the time. Both talents are just very strong. But I agree, for solo lane, Johanna Loss of Hope is just what you want. And we have an interesting split with Ophia on top lane and Leo, and Johanna bottom and Threema in the middle. They don't want to make anything risky here, they just play this without rotation, seems like.
Like, this would be interesting if they really planned it to pick it up. Because I just have to think about, they probably don't have an option against Lyric now. So they try to do something else, maybe. Or they just have always the plan that they just bring the 1-3-1 with Johanna on the bottom side.
Yeah,
like
doing the bottom camp now, the blue team, Money Picks. I heard that Calder always says Money Pick is the best best mount in the game. He said this since 2 years or something, so that would be a team for him. Maybe he's playing there undercover, I don't know.
Maybe
maybe
But we can talk about mounts here now. Okay, I'm totally in for it when nothing is happening in the game. But I don't think the money pick is. I think it's overrated. Like, especially when Carlos says it. Like, it's overrated.
I like the money pick, but that was there was a time where there were not that many mounts in the game, and money pick was one you could get by gold, and you didn't have to buy it with real money. Now you get that many mounts that you are not that you have so much to choose from. But what is your favorite mount though?
I would have to look at my collection. Yeah. I don't know the name from it. Like, I have so many favorite mounts, especially when they combine together with skins and stuff like that.
Yeah, you have to look for the right combination. That's true. The bottom shrine will be there. And it's a mortar fellow. Mortar Punisher. So the one who is considered the weakest right now. He brings some more siege damage, but let's see. So blue is already on the shrine with Mephisto doing some poking. And but nothing. Oh, a lot of damage comes here from the Ophia on Team Blue. Now Leo joins the battle. All are there. Garrosh is in trouble. Gets snapped by the Diablo. Still alive. And there is a Hansen falling as well. Two people falling. Tank is gone. There's a Genji in trouble. Has to move out. So yeah,
it's a very long fight going on here.
Like, yes, right.
It's just back and forth and forward and back. And now the Dwegger has to. Hope for his life, but Diablo cannot go in to follow him, will he?
There are nearly all shrine minions gathered for Team Blue. They have like 10 advantage, just 5 remaining or 6 remaining, so they can't poke it through. 5 remaining on the other hand, it's a 15. 4 remaining. Oh, there's some big damage on Leo and Lily. Both are falling, yes, just in the very same moment. Oh, and they're very close with shrine minions now. Very, very close. It's just one apart. Four, just same. Just both are missing 4. And there's so much damage on both sides. That's a disaster,
and this is the problem.
And there it is.
And this is the problem now for the team. And oh, 20 HP and even less. I think it was 11 on Garrosh who just walked out here. But this is the problem now on the team of the piggies, because they don't have any poke on the shrine. They don't have a real mate. They can just throw stuff in and they're fine.
Like Mephi can poke. Mephi can poke when he teleports in, though. But yeah, I agree.
Yeah, but the problem is he didn't pick up the very important level 4 talent here. Nealt Passant would give them easy this Punisher. He can just E in, Q through, kill every minion that is in near of him, and he would just take it and just sacrifice himself. The rest of the team don't have to go in, but he chooses to get the ghostly reach, so he has more range on his wing. So this could be a huge playmaker here now. Without Neil Passant, they have problems now to secure the shrine safely.
Yeah. So by the way, they got the keep the fort wall, but they didn't get the 4. They were able to defend that. Both are level 8, both have 2 kills. It's pretty even. So we have a nice, interesting match here. They are battling and throwing each other at each other, which is
that is what I expected from this kind of division. Like I saw games from lower divisions, they were so perfectly played.
Oh, and they got a snap on Garrosh. Will he be? He uses unstoppable. He can move out. Yes, he can. Oh no, he's turning back. No, you get out. He likes living on the edge. Seems like. He's now
it is indomitable here, and the armor bonus too. Like you don't have enough damage right now to kill him.
Monkass.
But like I want to mention, like I saw already a game in lower divisions, especially Division 6 where people literally played the macro game perfectly. They did the camps, they did camps on time. They had only 10 deaths until the end of the game, because then the team fight escalated and then it went up. So there are teams that are actually playing more the macro style. But this time we see 2 teams that just bash their heads against each other, especially
yes. Oh, Ophia gets
Ophia
picked,
now against Garrosh.
Oh my god, she's still alive. She can't. No, and she's dead, and Johanna has to walk away here. Oh, by the way, Teddy McTetster, thank you for following. Awesome name, guy. Teddy McTetster. if what somebody asked me how to name your Teddy, it would be Teddy McTetster. So
just
yeah,
Ted.
No, Teddy McTetster. Ted is short.
So now we just use level 10, like it's totally normal Warlord's challenge on Garrosh. with the entombed together and consumed souls, not the VoD ultimate. That is, I think in this case would be better, but yes, consumed souls can do a lot of damage too. And just to healing just for saving throws and X strike for Genji, so just to follow up with some damage when people are entombed and taunted.
On the other side, for the Gubba Gaming, we have Jack of 1000 Cups, Blessed Shield, Crushing Jaws, Dragon's Arrow, and Apoc. So yeah, I agree to you that the big root heroic, I forgot the name actually, it's named after the dungeon in which Matthew sits.
Durance of Hate.
Yes, Durance of Hate. That's it, right. And yes, I would have preferred this because it does a lot of damage and it has a way more cooldown. But for getting the picks, maybe it's fine. They have a Genji though for securing kills, so maybe the other one would be better. But I don't know. Let's see what it's working. Top Shrine will be next. It will be a Khan Punisher. Both are level 11. It's pretty even. A little bit lead for Team Blue with one kill more, but that's not the deciding factor. So Red is moving in on the Shrine a little bit earlier, getting a few minions ahead. Nothing more happening. Poke on the Garrosh, but he likes it. He gets some armor.
The thing is, on Garrosh having low is pretty bad for you because you cannot poke him so effectively like you would do in with max health. Oh, and now the engage from Diablo that was quite
damage
out,
on Genji.
But to catch Genji and just for healing healed Garrosh, and now they go for their combo with the Apocalypse and Crushing Jaws, and they try to get Garrosh, but they didn't get him, and the fight just escalates and Mephisto does this.
It's nothing more dying, but there was I thought the Crushing Jaws would connect somehow, and they got what, but there was no follow-up remaining, and yeah, that's just that. They killed the Genji, it's fine, and they have the control of the Shrine again.
I just figured out, now, with this one fight, the enemy that Gubba Gaming has 4 stuns now with the ultimates.
Gubba Gaming has all their heroics out right now, and on the sides of the money picks, there's everything there except for Ancestral. There's a follow.
Yeah,
thank you. It's Poppin' Fresh. Thank you. By the way, Poppin' Fresh. That's damage happening. Leaf fell. Killed by Mephisto. Mephisto now porting and doing damage and poking. And there's the control over the Shrine for Team Blue. They have to catch up, and 33. Shrine minions already taken for Team Red, but Blue is now having control and getting something. There's damage engaged happening from Unstoppable coming a little bit too late. Garrosh was able to thrown from Diablo, but did not fall. No, another throw on Joanna, focus from Genji, but they're just damaged on the front line. And Garrosh falls, but is it enough to secure the Shrine? We don't know. Nice, there's our damage from Diablo again. Hard engage. Genji's in trouble. He falls again. He gets another clap from the Diablo. He doesn't like this. Control over the Shrine from Gubba Gaming. And they control it. They have it. They got the second Shrine as well. And now they go for the 4.
Yeah, there you have a 100 Black Soulstone Diablo in their face, and he just healed so much they cannot kill him, and you don't need even a healer to buff him up.
Yeah, that's true. If you get the Q stun,
he uses E or Q, and
yeah, he has life leech on 4, and it's silly Diablo offlaner. New tank meter incoming. So Garrosh completes his quest. They have to abandon that fort. The fort is lost. If they stay there, they will lose people. They have to go behind the keep wall, but the immortal will jump in a moment. Will he? Can they bait him? No, they don't care. They're just defending in front of the gates. There is not much life left. They lost the fort. It's alright. Level 13 is soon there for both teams, but it's nearly level lead for the Gubba Gaming. The Division 7 team is leading currently against the Division 6 team. And
now comes my turn, level 13. This is my time to shine. I know everything about level 13.
Yeah, it's level 13. Now I get that. Team Blue doing the Pissoir camp here again, the Piss Peasant camp. And Red did the bottom camp. They have the advantage. They take the bottom camp. Oh, whoa, whoa. 5-4 kills.
I have to... normally I know Consumed Souls, yeah? Consumed Souls is so strong because you combine it with a level 1 talent that is, I don't know how called, but it gives you more spell power when you teleport.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have a Q that he now has, so it's a 20% spell power. And the good thing is, above these two talents normally stack each other. So you can use your Q, hit someone on the enemy team, then press E in any direction, and then just ult and doing an engage. Now the damage is missing from the level 1 talent, but he has finished his quest, yes, at least very fast.
That's really fast, but right.
How he will use it properly in team fights. Like, the team fights were so messy, and he gets some resets, yeah, but he didn't do enough damage on the two tanks. Like, Johanna always be alive. Diablo always be alive. Lily only died because she was way out of position and this engaged on them.
Yeah, they really don't have a tool to threaten the tanks except for Leo. But Mephi and Genji, they don't do enough damage to threaten the biggest tanks like Joanna and Diablo. Mephi is poke, Genji is finish, and little poke before, so they don't have something that just sustained damage down the tanks. And Gubba Gaming did really well with that draft. So
there was ambitious ultimate. Ambitious best shield used from Johanna on the Mephistos was jumping in. He just pulled it back immediately because, yeah, you're immortal when you use your E. You can be stunned, yeah, but you just go back afterwards.
Yeah, and they secured the bottom four, though. That's fine. They are close to level 16, so they will have about half a level time for having that advantage. Shrine won't be
there. But they miss an important piece, like the Well of Eternity, or however it's called, Fountain, is still standing here. Like, they can still shuck from it. Probably Johannes not going for
Leo
it.
Leo got called on top. Killed, nicht called.
Leo's never been killed. Leo just floating around, like, that is his job to die. That is trade value over
Yeah, that's really trade value. So level 16 for both when the shrine is up. It's all fine. Level 6 to 4 kills, and Red is moving in the shrine first. They have the control, they got like 10 lead. Leo will be pop up again in a while. Mephi jumping in but gets popped out. There we go. So,
Red. And now they have their first advantage to probably do damage to a tank.
Garrosh lurking in the shadows. Oh, no, we don't get pick. Oh, that's not a good throw. Taunt on Joanna, but you can see they can't really threaten the tanks and they can't play over them. That's so much damage now happening on the Genji, but he was able to get the Ancestral out first. Damage again on the Garrosh here. Garrosh, oh, there's so much mischief happening on all sides. Everybody's still alive. The tanks are just bashing against each other. There's Garrosh falling. Garrosh falls first.
This Diablo is just walking in, just auto-attacking Garrosh, and he's doing max health damage. So you have to be worried about this as Garrosh, because armor is not protecting you from max health damage.
Right. That's a really good pick, that Diablo, actually, on this map. And the Genji again gets killed, and the next Punisher, the important third Punisher in the lane where the four already fell, goes over to Gubba Gaming again. And Gubba Gaming, not Gubba Gaming. And they will be pushing for the keep here.
Like, even I have to say it's a weird build, but I don't think even Diablo was the point, but the build is the point. Like, this Diablo can just auto-attack everything that is in his face and can just heal himself so good. And yes, with a little one talent too, he just heals when he upheavals or just slams someone against the wall.
Like, the keep will fall for sure here. If they get a kill, they can play for more, but they don't want to do that. They disengage, they get what they wanted. But it was a good pick, I think. They maybe expected something more squishier, I don't know. But with the Genji Mephisto comp, they just can't threaten that big tank that much.
And now is the point. Like, normally I see Diablo is banned, but this time Diablo was not banned. Yeah. So
maybe they thought they have Johanna, we don't need to ban him. don't pick
that's
him.
That's true. And then the other problem is, normally you don't expect a Diablo against the Garrosh, because Garrosh is so good against Diablo, is against Garrosh. Like, they're both countering themselves with the throws or either the knockback into immediately killing people.
But if you have Johanna and Diablo, that's something more. By the way, Leo was able to sneak the top key wall. Meanwhile.
Yeah, while they were just pushing, there was like 4 deafing, but I think it's not a good trade for the keep against the keep wall. But now they have something to work with, but the next Punisher is on the mid lane, so both sides have this strong option here. Like, no wall is actually fully down, both forts are still standing.
This Punisher maybe won't decide too much if they really don't have a big wipe, so it will take some time. So taking the Shaman camp on top for Team Red. Blue is on the bottom lane trying to sneak some XP bounded in the wall there, I think. But maybe Red is moving in here, do they? Genji is anchoring in the bushes to check, and they know there's somebody coming. Diablo and Joanna from the flank, what are they doing? Leo is E out. Yep. Okay, they disengage. Yes, they disengage. They won't fight. Don't want to fight here. But they could, maybe, because they are still on even talent here, and level 20 is about to happen for Gubba Gaming in a moment. And then that's
not they awkward. Could. They have to fight now. When they hit level 20 after that, they don't have really an option.
Oh,
and
nice
they start
combo
to fight
here.
Off now, but they like just to look at the healing of Diablo, he just sits there now
yeah.
with the
they don't interrupt the Lily heal as well.
But those sides can really kill someone.
Level 20.
Everyone is thinking on the fountain.
Oh,
and
nice.
They catch two people.
Oh, that's it. Two dead people.
They kill two people.
Joanna.
And level 20 gets so.
Joanna had her indestructible up. That's why she didn't die as well. But that was a nice. They needed this. That was very important. Getting this kills in this moment. That was maybe the key to turn this match around. So now the window is open. They can reach level 20. They can get an advantage on the shrine, and then they are all even again, and we will see a final battle, and that will be cool.
Like now they have to soak fast for level 20. They need this now before the enemy team is up again, but I think they will achieve this. 30 seconds to go, 30 seconds to go until the shrine is active, and they can actually try for pushing it up to 10, maybe 15 before the full team can arrive there. But
they have to defend bottom right now?
It cannot decide because yet, like I said, both teams have everything up on the middle lane, but you can actually push up when this wave is not removed, what they try to do now at least, so they have not so much pressure. But the winning side is actually at the moment on Gubba Gaming, because they have all time in the world now. Like, they can just let the bottom lane push and just stall it out.
Am I right? Ophir didn't pick the heals her 20 left yet, is it?
No, I see this too. Maybe she's just waiting for an important moment to pick it. Or she just forget it.
That would be silly. She should take the upgrade for Crushing Jaws. But let's see. There's an engage from Diablo picking. Get thrown away from Garrosh. Genji has to be careful. Damage from both sides. Epoch used. It did not really connect. Unstoppable from the Garrosh. Damage on both sides. Lily Jack is not cancelled. She sees so much with the double Jack now. And everybody is up on life from Team Red. Oh, and Genji just got deleted there from the Diablo. And Joanna, that could be silly for Team Blue. They have to be careful right now. If they don't, they have to disengage, I think. Oh, but they have 30 picks already. If they want 30 minions, if they get 20, it could work. Garrosh gets some big damage here on the top, but he's still alive. 35 to 30. It would be so important for Team Blue to get those minions. And it looks good. It looks good. Just one left thing missing. And yes. Garrosh falls for
and
this.
I wanted to shout, where is Neil Passant's lyric? But they didn't even need it. They just take it. They pushed out 4v5. Why they let them push out so easily?
Oh, Ophir died.
And no, wow, the punished crushed Ophir. Like, this is just a slam dunk on Ophir together with the... what are this on the shoulders? I think artillery stuff. And they did so much damage on this poor Ophir. They just...
got immortal. John Cena. And yes, that was nice. They don't push with this, though. They don't have the people alive for pushing. It was just Mephi and Riga alive in that moment. So they take the camp. That's good what they do. So everything is still open. Both are level 21. They will both be up for the next shrine. So if there won't happen a wipe, we will see a next interesting shrine fight here, which is nice. So Mixin 88, you said
now.
let's say for GG. I understand what he said. You want to say Gubba Gaming, that's GG. I'm so stupid.
The problem is now, like, the next Punisher, either he spawns top or bottom. Like, when it spawns bottom, it cannot be a win condition. But now it's a 22 plus minute
Punisher.
Not
for Blue, but for Red.
This thing is hurting. Even when you try to defend it, when the enemy team is alive standing there, you just get wiped by Punisher and the enemy team because they immediately can follow up.
Yes.
And it spawned on the top lane, the only lane where both teams still have something standing there. So this can actually be the finish.
Like, yes, it should be the finish at that time. But let's see. Let's be surprised. They are sitting in front of each other here, poking and dancing, but nothing more happening. They don't want to take a risk. Now everybody's careful here. Yeah. Let's see. The blue team really... the piggy banks here, they really have to be careful, because if the Diablo gets the city engaged like this, it's a lot of damage. Oh, stunned. And will Garrosh survive this? It can be terrific. Oh, Ancestral did not take off. That was a lot of damage suddenly from the Hanzo. Maybe that was a good Hanzo hit here. He had that much armor, but he just deleted. That was surprising.
I think it is a Dragon Hungers. Like, I have to watch this in the replay, how much stacks he had before he shot the Q on Garrosh. Mm. But I think it was a high stack Dragon Hungers. So you have 20% bonus damage on a not even finished quest target practice. But I think it's already enough. Because
yeah, and maybe get some... Did he use his W as well? I don't know. He was close to the wall. I did not see that correctly. But
I didn't see it correctly too. Yeah. But there's no max health damage on Hanzo, but it still dudes some damage.
But he will be back in time for this important shrine fight. Red now can push out the lanes a little bit because they have one person not on the map. Yeah, but I like what they're doing. They steal the camp. That's good. So they can push out the lanes a little bit to have the advantage. And maybe blue is doing a mistake, like fighting 4 against 5 here. And oh, that could be problematic. They use their heroics now, especially the Mephi heroic might be missing on the giant fight. Garrosh is there now, we are 5 against 5. But they can win the camp.
And there's another good thing. Like, yeah, the Mephisto ult got used, but
you're right.
the enemy team, like, the next fight will be probably without 2 ultimates, one from Diablo and one from Mephisto, because Lyric has it up again, and when they engage on the next 20 seconds, they have the advantage, and in 10 seconds, the Silence Tomb is up, and then they will get really hard problems here.
There's no Jux right now up, it's still 25 seconds to go, so it can be terrific.
Let's see now there it goes in, maybe for the important.
Oh, what is Diablo doing here in the back line? But can he survive this? Genji is really has a problem against that Diablo. Oh, nice dragons. Oh, you're connecting with a lot of damage. Joanna stuns everybody. Damage on the Garrosh. There's a silence and tomb on the back line. That's a lot of damage. Oh my god, there's so much damage. But nobody falls right now. Garrosh still in trouble here. Gets picked out, uses the turn. Oh, indestructible using. Yeah, Diablo is really doing what he wants. Jux is now out, healing up, but Lily can't really move into to heal them because she's pushed away to the side. No healing. Orphea will fall, most likely. What is he doing? Kill that Orphea. My goodness. That is interesting turnaround in this fight. Nice. They did well. They're fighting for that camp. I thought it was a mistake, but it was nice. They could. Draw all the cooldowns from Gubba Gaming and tap control of the shrine. On the bottom there's something pushing in. Genji has to defend. But that was interesting.
I think now is the chance for Gubba Gaming at least to go in, because Genji is not with them.
Yes.
So they can just run in and try to do something. And Lyric should zoning and not Garrosh. Garrosh gets so much damage.
Oh, Garrosh still alive, but so much damage. Didn't connect with us. Oh, it's Silence and Tomb on the tanks. Leo is closing the door. Taunt happening, but Garrosh falls in that moment. Nobody else falls. Oh, that can be deciding here. Damage from Mephi happening on the backline, but nobody falls. Oh, damage on Lily as well from Genji. On the one hand, there's Leo falling, but also the Lily falls, and Hanzo might fall as well. The backline is gone. We just have Diablo and Joanna, the big people standing there. Damage on Rega here, but that won't be enough. They have Mephi and Rega, that's a lot of mobility, and Genji as well. On the other side, there's Orphea back, so we are 3-on-3. Orphea is a hero, Jux is up again, we have just the Ancestral on the other side. Blue is trying to get all the shrine minions here. Will they succeed? Will they?
Like, both cores are now under attack. The one has 2 catapults and the other side has 2 catapults.
Oh my god, we have a car race for minions.
But now the first Punisher is going off the top lane, this time for the piggies. Mm-hmm. And they can now walk in with it and Oof, this will be hard now.
Leo is defending. Mephi had to port back for mana, so they can't really push right now with Riga and Genji. Only you have to be careful that Red is not making an pausing a fight. But everybody will be up there. Leo still missing. He has to come now. He has to come. So Leo, move, move, move. Oh no, he got dismounted. And then there's a fight. Frost Punisher, Frozen Punisher is deactivating the minion. The building. Hanzo tries to poke down the Genji. The keep will fall, and now it's getting interested. Garrosh is there. Leo is still not there. We have a 4 against 5 plus John Cena. Oh, so much damage here happening now. Taunt on the Diablo. Will he fall? Oh, nice. Dragons are securing the Diablo. And
the Frozen Punisher is now on the core.
He is on the core. Oh, and there's the Leo, and he does the silence in tomb. Where it is? There, no, where it is? Do the entomb. No, he doesn't. But it's enough. It should be game. It should be. Oh, is it? Oh, so much damage. Nobody died yet. Nobody. There it is. Nobody died, but the core. That was close for Diablo.
Like it's the HP from Diablo. It's just so low.
He has black XP.
Not
yeah.
Invisible anymore. Like, oof.
So wow. That was an intense fighting match, right? It wasn't that silly high focus, but it was a lot of interesting fighting on both sides. Let me switch back to the overlay. There we are. Greetings. Everyone.
I would just analyze this game with one word. Hero sprawl.
No, come on.
Nothing else. It was like it. Every time they stood on the lane, you just saw them 5v5. Just try to mash them, and at the start it was went very well for Gubba Gaming here. It just got the advantage, but they could not push the advantage. They were only at one point the highest one level ahead of them, and they could never extend it. They had all the map pressure, they had all the push pressure, they had the pressure on the points, on the shrines. But they didn't succeed with finish it because they sent always Leoric when they defend as four, and they didn't push in with the Punisher. Yeah. The Punisher jumps alone in, and they still hammering against the wall and say, "Let me in, let me in," and they cannot. It could be way, played way better, but this time you have to say, yeah. It's Division 7. Like they cannot.
Oh, come on, yeah.
But completely, they cannot. They don't have the confidence to do that kind of stuff. Oh, like for example, Division 1 players have. I don't say they are bad. I don't say they played bad. Like especially the Diablo, I have to point out this Diablo was going nuts. But you already saw every time with a push, they were like, "Nah, should we do more or not?" And this was always very unsure if they really want to do more.
And I think just Gubba Gaming had the control for a long time. They could, they secured the shrine. The double tank draft was just working for them. But yeah, then there was actually this deciding battle when actually Gubba Gaming had the advantage at that camp, at that shaman camp, where they were able money picks were able to draw to bait four heroics from Gubba Gaming, and that was enough to secure the shrine, and in the end it worked out. But yeah, we saw nice fights taken at any opportunity here in this map from both sides. Nice fighting with damage on both sides. Nobody was able to quickly finish. Tanks just standing everywhere. And but it was, I think it was entertaining. It was nice. I like it. I like to stream the matches like this. It's just cool. So
cool. Just cool.
Just cool.
Into the mouth.
And map pick is chosen, but they don't know which map yet. So remaining maps are Cursed Temple, Tomb, and Volskaya. Spoda Queen it is. So, yeah, can you create again?
Like always I can do.
It doesn't wonder. I'm not surprised that this map is Tomb, because in my opinion, after Shrines, Tomb is the second most. It feels like the second easiest and most picked map, because you can also easily rotate and play the four-man rotation. So, if I were on a team that has no time to train at all and think for weird tactics or whatever, I would prefer those two maps, Tomb and Shrines, because you can always pull a four-man rotation. But and yeah, there's not that room for so much weird tactics, but they are good. They're very good for brawly matches, and that's what we want to see, right?
Oh no, not another brawly match. I cannot stand
this. They're even closer together this time. That's more brawl happening.
Yeah, maybe we will see some cheese picks too, like Tomb of the Spider Queen. When I call this, it's always the cheesiest map of all of them, especially in a competitive environment. Like you can pick something like Cho'Gall. You can pick something like Xul. You can pick something like Asmodan Johanna. Like there's so much stuff that you can pick here that is actually a little bit cheesy, but can do so much work when it works. And I think everyone has to be aware of this. Like, yeah, Cho'Gall is a very, very cheesy pick, but especially this map is so good because he can rotate after the four alone, the top and bottom, and sweep.
Yeah, all lanes are so close together. You don't have the need to play something for. Also, camps are not that important, so you don't have to care for that. Wave clear is important, vision is important, both big things on this map. You have to have wave clear because you need the shards for the turn in, and you have to control the turn in points. So vision and poke and stuff like this is important for the turn in points, and everything else is just rotating and brawling and having a plan a little bit, of course. Yes, but you can't. There is not that big macro place on this map. Let's see what it's gonna be. The interesting thing, if you have a brawly match like this, you see the team fights, and you know there's nothing happening in a blink of an eye. You can just see, look at it, and see brawling there, there, forth, back, and everybody is dropping low and high and again, and somebody might fall, and it's just cool. I like this. I actually, before the scaling changes, I think 2 or 3 years ago, a lot of HOTS gameplay was more like that, which was cool.
The thing is, why so many games were like that was of the double support meta. Like you have two supports. It was even after that?
Yes,
like I don't think after that.
Do you remember the scaling chances? I think 3 years ago.
But still, I don't think it was more looking like that. Like the scaling was changed, yeah, but everything remained on the same point. So
I think it got a little bit more deadly. Before that, you were just going to the fight and fighting and fighting and fighting, and somebody died, and then they changed it that it was you were more able to get a pick on somebody who was out of position. But well, the support meter was another thing. I think that was after that, but that was the same thing. You're right.
Like, especially when you just pick Uta, Rhaegar, and stuff like that, people that are like, supports and can fight. Like,
yeah,
so you just want to fight, and you brawl in on the same point. Everyone was slow, everyone was disengaging, and then everyone was healed up again because double support. And especially with Tassadar meta, especially in HGC back then, like Tassadar was must pick or must ban because he was one of the best brawler back then with Arcan or with like the wall level 20 is just disgusting.
Yeah, true. Yeah, Tassadar, there will be a rework maybe soon. Or maybe also, we got a Chen rework announced now. It is on the PTR already. Nobody expected that. I think it was a meme like Chen, nerf Chen. But now they reworked him so they can nerf him again. Fine.
Yeah, and we see the same bans here for the piggies. Like, Kel'Thas Deckard, they don't want to see this from...
Yeah. If they ban the Arthas now, it's exactly the same bans like in the first map.
I really don't want to see us the same game again. Just on a lower match.
Different like, background, yeah.
Oh, oof. Okay, actually, there's a Johanna pick now
Johanna
for the
Johanna first, so good. And yeah, Johanna, good for the rotation, can clear all the lanes. Bastards. And there's the Leo on the other hand. And in Hansel. Hansel again.
I'm disappointed. Like I would think like they just picked now what the enemies played last time. But actually, nah. I think for I4, the second roles, hero we can play is Hansel.
Leo is a good on this map. He can quickly wave clear. He can control the turning point somewhat. And the Entomb is strong engaged here on the very narrow passages. Jaina and Tyrande. Jaina, in my opinion, the most all-round mage, can do a lot. It's fine for most of situations. if they take the garage now, he will have a bad time. But let's see which tank they will take. Actually, they have a real bruiser right now with Leo, so that we won't see a double tank, except for maybe the money picks will do so this time.
Maybe they pick now the Diablo solo lane or Johanna solo lane. Yeah. Who knows? And oh, don't tell me they want to pick Cho'Gall now.
Like, oh, they have the Leo picked. They have yes, they could. They have the Leo picked.
Oh no!
They have Anubis out. Leo is taken.
Hopefully, they don't watching the map. The match now, so they will just ban Cho something.
We have 20 seconds delay.
You could ban Tychus either of Greymane, but this would be too obvious. No, Greymane you can ban when you want
and
to.
I don't think that Tychus is that good because he has to get close and then he can get picked out by the others.
Oh no. Come on. A Cho'Gall would be so good now to see here. But yeah, sadly, you have to really know how to play him and have to know how to play him in a team environment.
But you're right. It looked really like a draft for this. Banning the Greymane and Anub, taking the Leo. Malphite was still there. Now. I think Malphite was a big problem here.
No, I can explain you why. Level 30 now is a cocoon for Cho'Gall himself. So he can just avoid it after. Ah. Like, it's not on 16 anymore.
So it's again. But this time with the Jaina backup.
Blaze.
Yeah, so sustain and engage comes from Blaze. And what will be the healer for Team Red? What it'll be? An Abatur. No, not on this map. Just Lily again, maybe. They like the Lily.
I just tried to. There's a Lucio option still to. Okay.
Just when you mentioned.
I just watching their champions and they just picked the Lucio after I called it out. So this is very scary right now.
Thank you for the variation mixing. So they said Chen and Diva will get reworked. Tessari will not get so soon rework. Ah, yes. So they said Chen and Diva, right? I thought they said Tassadar and D.Va, but okay, if they say Chen and D.Va, I knew that D.Va will be getting one. D.Va is really in need of a rework. She is just awkward to put into a draft somehow, so these are a lot of fun. But yeah. Yeah, going back to this draft here, which draft do you like more?
Very hard to say. Like, I saw the last game, how much board it was. Really think that probably the Gubba Gaming is pretty a little bit stronger here with Hanzo Li Ming. They have a lot of poke. And Tyrande is not the best support to heal poke up. But I think we'll see it in the game, how it will work.
Yes. So we have to zoom out and push all the right buttons here. So on the left side, we have the Money Picks with a 1-0 lead and the Blue Petunia on a Blaze. Risa playing, what are you, Joanna. Huxley playing Tyrande, Goka playing Genji again, and Yveen on Jaina. And
yeah, on the right side we have, I just have to laugh about the left side, but on the right side we have Dakar on Leo, Art4, Erd4 on Lucio, I4 on Hanzo. Mike E on Murden, and we have Beasten on Li Ming, and they just do the chain of piggies here to walk around stuff, and they got interrupted. How rude!
So, will they secure the
second
one?
Can we report Club of Gaming for unsportsmanlike behavior there?
So we have the party mix for Genji, Lucio already getting some stacks in. Q again for Hanzo, Q for Murden as well. Power hungry Li Ming. And there is loss of hope on the other side, and nothing special. Fingers of frost for Jaina. And Leo goes to the bot lane, will be visited by Genji here.
So I see something strange. Adrenaline Stimpak on Blaze. This is more attack speed and more movement speed for 5 seconds. Will this be an auto attack Blaze, or is this just a style to push the lane? Like, he duels Cleric in his W. This is not a good decision. Like,
maybe he wants
Petunia is in very hard trouble.
Yes, I don't know why he did take that. Interesting choice.
He is already on down.
Why not? You always take the more damage. Of course you always take the more damage. Believe in numbers.
Yeah, it's just walling. So yeah, we probably a bit more damage is better here. I really miss the old level 1 talent when it actually did cooldown reduction bonus, even on your ultimate.
From Blaze, the
yeah, from
yes,
Blaze,
yeah, the purple one, right? Yeah.
Yeah, it just gives you more cooldown reduction, and it gives you cooldown reduction
mana,
on your
right?
ult. You can just and mana. So they nerfed this, so don't give you heroic cooldown anymore, and they nerfed it, so it gives you less mana.
Yeah,
so it's a hard choice to pick.
True. I since a while I prefer actually the active that gives you unstoppable. So gathering 50 globes, I think, then you get unstoppable, and it also helps you in lowering the cooldown on your trade. I like this first pick on Blaze since they buffed it a little bit. So whenever you hit your Q, it helps you to lower the cooldown of your D, and you also get an unstoppable on your D when you have 15 globes, which is fine. So I have to admit I experimented with Blaze main tank a little bit in unranked matches, and I like this. He doesn't work in all situations, but it's somewhat like an Arthas, you know. Arthas doesn't work in all situations as a tank, but can work in some situations. Main tank. So yeah. Let's see. The bottom Blaze is in trouble, is he? He'll get visited by two tanks. Also by two big in skies.
The main problem about Blaze main tank, like, Blizzard wants to make Blaze main tank work. They buffed everything up, so he is actually a main tank. They buffed a little bit of his talent. And Blaze is potentially in trouble, but he cannot tap anymore. So he has to go back and someone has to lane up.
So they use this opportunity for taking the bottom camp, but just two tanks there. And that is, they have two tanks against two DDs here. That's very interesting.
Yeah, but these two tanks are scary. You have Lyric here that has huge auto attacks, and you have Muradin. Like, no one should underestimate Muradin, like, especially with Perfect Storm. Just
so
every time
blue
damage
should maybe sneak in a turn in right now when red is doing the bottom camp, but nope, they want to fight. Of course they want to fight. Everybody wants to fight. They are there for fighting. Don't care for the turn in. They get the bottom camp. They are fighting in the bottom lane. Genji is not there, so. Nobody falling right now. Nope. We have 10 turn-in charts remaining for Gubba Gaming and 25 for the Piggy Banks. The Money Picks, I'm sorry.
So both teams can actually do a turn-in. But the first spiders have the same issue like nearly every first objective. It's not the strongest, and you literally just normally pick it up, and normally the second team that gets the second spiders, like either the first team that got the second or the other team got her first, will have the stronger push when they all survive. And this is, I think, the main problem on this map. Like, it's better to have it not, and oof, it's one of the very good passives that just
you rather yes you rather wait a little bit longer with your first turn in and play it safe, and then if you are able to get a value with a push and immediate turn in the second time, that's a really strong play. But if you just sneak a early turn in, it doesn't make that much. Though the Genji falls.
And Genji falls. I think it was the auto text from Lucio that was following him after he eats.
Yes. Did not
and
see that.
And actually killed him. Oh no.
There's the first turn in happening for Gubba Gaming a little bit in the lead again, like on the first map. So they know what brawling means. So they have
a
lot of poke here.
They now take all the walls. When they don't take all the walls, this turn-in was not worth it. But even when he gets the walls, you get a little bit of XP. Not so much before the changes of the experience of the buildings.
Well, if they can get a kill, that would be worthy. Yeah? Like they can cut away the gems from Team Blue. That would be
yeah.
Big. You know, so they go for the tactic pushing bot first with three men. You can do that. There are two possibilities. Of course, the top lane is the most important on this map. That's why you want to push top mostly, so you can take the boss, and that's the win condition. There's some damage happening here. What is happening? 3 against 4. Nobody dying. 4 against 5 now. Oh, nice from the Joanna. Blaze is also there in the middle. Genji still missing. Doesn't rotate. It's not rotating now. Blaze just walks away. There's no. Oh my god, that's a huge damage coming out. But all alive. Leo is terrible. Leo. Oh my god. Leo can make a lot of terror here.
He wants to kill the people.
That's close.
But he can't.
And Leo is now in trouble. That was very close. They got the bottom four though. And now both are level 9.
Now the Division 7 team Gubba Gaming has to adjust. Blue Petunia failed now the second time the E into more people. She just engaged without hitting someone with a stun. So he just stood there in the enemy team. And I think when this will not improve, this can be horrible for the piggies here. Like, Blaze just get catched out because he charged in. And with 27 coins now, it's very, very dangerous to just charge in into nothing.
Yeah. What I was telling before, so some teams push top because they want to prepare the top lane as a win condition with the boss, but some others also push in the bottom lane, so you can, like, if the bottom lane is pushed and there's a big wave, the enemy has to react to that wave somewhere. That gives you some possibility to go for the boss yourself, or because the bottom lane, if it's pushed in, is a little bit longer than the other lanes, they are more far away from the turning points, and that's why if you push bottom first, you have a little bit more map control when the enemy has to defend. And those are the two approaches you have on this map. There we are, see some battling happening here. Both are level 10, by the way. We see Blast Shield, X-Strike, Ring of Frost, Shadowstalk, and Bunker Drop. And on the other side, we see Sound Barrier, Dragon's Arrow, Entomb Avatar, and Disintegrate. That's a level 7. I like it.
Like, what you talk about the map, like, you have these two approaches, yeah, but the thing is why the top lane is so important, because there's a boss. Yeah. But what is the boss doing when all the keeps are up? Yeah, he's doing really nothing. He just dies at the first keep he sees and do nothing. And with the bottom lane push. Oh, they catch on Lyric, but Lyric is even so ready. Yeah, he can go out.
Oh, Ring is used. Oh, getting the Lucio. But everybody's alive. Jaina falls. Lucio gets off his heroics, barely surviving. Entomb on the Joanna, he's in trouble. There's the disintegrate right in your face, and that's enough for the Joanna. Just port in front of the Joanna and disintegrate.
And this is now very bad for the base, because they cannot push with it. They cannot get anything out of it. When they just defend it properly, they will not even lose something from the wall. And this is bad. Like, this is the second spider of the game. The first one, for the piggies, but like this is a spider that actually do something that can grant you a first fort, and they didn't succeed because they failed to re-engage. Like, this Jaina Ring of Frost was so good, but the follow-up was not there, and Jaina's out of position again. Oh, God, now it gets two tanks, but there are four people around it.
People in the bush, and they don't help, they run away.
They don't help
him! The damage happened. Blaze is charging in. There's enough trouble for everybody here. Damage on both sides, nobody falling. What is going on there? Muradin, does he want to fight or does he want to run? He's running, he has no mana, he can't do anything. He will fall here, get stunned and focused. That was overstaying here. And they are about to have a second turn in.
And I really thought they want to let the Jaina die. Yeah. Like, the Jaina runs there for her life and was like, guys, help me. And then the two guys in the
same moment
just said, nope, I don't want. We just go on Hanzo. And Jaina was like, okay, then you do that.
Oh, Blue is trying for another turn in, and Hanzo tries to interrupt that, but he gets a lot of damage. Leo now coming from the bottom. They don't want to give them their turn in. Mura is on the way back, so no turn happening. Oh, nice Dragon's Arrow on the Jaina. Yeah, the Ring of Frost before that Jaina did was a very long range Ring of Frost. She connected with that on Lucio, but there was no possibility to follow up. That was kind of close, but it started a fight that they lost. So
this Jaina is so often out of position, just face checking its tank. All the tanks falling too fast back. Like, oof.
Turn in for red, happening. Yes, there's the red turn in. Gubba Gaming with its turn in. So, second turn in for red. Both have won already. Bottom lane is pushed a lot. So now they see Joanna is on bottom lane to defending. That gives some opportunity, but the turn in already happened. So they are now going for the top lane, seems like. Yes. they most likely want to make play for getting both fours, at least one four. Let's see if they can succeed in that. Going for the bottom lane is would be too much right now. Level 13 for both, 3-1 kills. It's kind of even, just have a level lead. Joanna come from the bottom, but she's alone. Right, she's more ruling there alone. Joanna, what are you doing? Be careful there. She's getting so much poke damage right here. Genji is coming from behind as well. But it's in trouble. He's going there using the protected. Nice, but that lets him survive, but he didn't get that much value out of that. Top will be defended though. Looks nice. All red weapons are already defended. And there's Jaina falling. Catched.
Yeah, Jaina was again out of position.
I think so too. Oh, nice entomb here. Very nice entomb. But Genji is able to get away, except for Joanna. She can't. She gets face disintegrated again.
Oof, this is a heavy game to cast here, but you see it again. Like, this Jaina was getting
going
too
for the
close.
Boss here.
She don't have to get so close, like her E. Yeah, it looks like she don't have so much range on it.
There we get
but
that
this
boss.
Thing have a huge range on lengths, so you don't have to step up so far.
Yeah, they're going for the boss, and they will secure that boss. Nothing blue can do. And there's the boss going for the keep wall. Blue, though, they have used their web weavers, so they won't. But red is gonna do here, they will defend mid and bot while the boss is moving in on top. So that is like a turn in that does not do very much, like the other turn in also did not that much. And it's okay, it's just even. They want to brawl, they don't want to win with their objective.
The thing now is that the objective helps to defend the boss. Like, they would lose much more when the objective will not help to defend. And I think it was just a good thing to a little bit catch up with the levels. Again, there's only one level between them.
But it's level 16 in a few seconds coming there for Gubba Gaming, Gubba Gaming, for GG.
They have to extend the lead more when they have so much
Joanna
pressure.
Joanna is in the middle of the bunch again.
So good.
Murin jumping in as well. They want to brawl. They don't want to brawl. Oh, Ring of Frost now connecting. Also, don't get the Ming. Lucio gets off his heroic. Very important. Murin gets a lot of damage here. Moving in. Nobody falling still yet. Li Ming has to be careful. Gets followed up by the Genji. Joanna falls. Disintegrate the Genji just in your face. And the Genji falls as well. Looks good. Another nice entomb. But the bunker in the entomb. That is not what he was expecting. So much fortification. But that's not enough for Blaze to survive. Dead they are, three people. So they have a huge lead here, 8-1 kills. It just worked this time for the Division 7 team against the Division 6 team.
Like, this game is so well, but like I said, they now have 1.5 leads. This is an acceptable lead to work on.
Now
they have the next objective, the next web weavers.
And the third one,
they
is
have
very
to
important.
Go now bottom.
Maybe they want to take, because it's the mid four and then move bottom. I don't know. I hope so. But most likely they will be pushing for mid keep as well. Let's see what they're doing. Getting the top four here now with advantage without the web weavers. It's a good call. I think I like it. And now let's see if they move bot. Yeah, they do. They do. Nice. They move through the corridor, moving bottom. Oh, and the Genji, she was really out of position. That's just dangerous. When the four is gone on bottom, this corridor is very easy for a backdoor. And yeah, she forgot about that, seems like. And that was very important pick for the making the play towards picking getting the keep here. So
I think this is now a really possibility here too, because it's 4v5 and even Blaze is still defending topside, so it's 3v5. And again, they're struggling to just try to search a fight. They have every ult up, they have entomb up, they have to search a fight now.
Oh,
come on, entomb! There's entomb! Come on!
Oh, nice dragon. Dragon's arrow, there it is.
Oh, the Tyrant is so close! I actually got killed!
Oh, Piggy Bank has really to be careful. They are about to lose the game here, but they might disengage. They have to disengage from Genji, killed the Hanzo. There's the pick they needed to survive somehow here. They're in trouble now. Blaze is in trouble. They are all very low and they don't have a support, but they can defend the keep, actually. They managed to defend the keep. And that's big.
Both teams want to brawl, and then I see five people against three with the Web Weaver. standing in front of their keep and doing nothing. This is not brawling. This is just hesitating with their options.
But they like, go for the keep now. So Leo pushing them away. They rest securing the keep. It's right. Yes, that would be silly to let the keep survive this. They have all the tools to poke it down.
The other thing, the Jaina snared the hands on the back then with a long range ring of frost. That's why he dies. Like, they could follow up on this with Genji and with Blaze. But when they would engage earlier, don't give them the chance to let Jaina respawn to really get the aggression on the building. Like, they can just ignore Jaina for the whole last of the fight, and they could not go for a finish, of course. Like, this would be way too early, and I think the cooldowns or the timers at least are way too short. But it, like, they don't have to hesitate with such a lead. Like, oof.
Yeah, and that's it. They have they are just nearly half a level away from level 20, and usually this is the time where Team Blue, the money pick, they have to force a fight now, as long as they are an even talent here. But it's because it's still just kind of open, just 4% more scaling for the red team because one level lead. But they should search a fight now, but they're not doing. They're giving red the time to catch up until level 20. And if they have level 20, they have more than one level time with an advantage. And you don't want to give that away.
I don't even think they don't search a fight. They are not able to start a fight properly. But now, the tank is overstaying, but he can just jump out.
Yeah, nobody has a turn right now. They have to brawl. Level 20 is there just in a few moments. Where it is? Level 20 not there yet, but now they're disengaged. They don't want to fight level 20. There it is. They have a talent advantage for more than a level time. And let's see what they can make out of it. They could even try to get the boss, but
I think the boss would be a too ballsy play yes. Here. Like, they have to stay there, but the problem is they have to wander. If they wander, they can just catch, search, and but they catched out Johanna on
the Jaina. They go straight for the Jaina. And bunker is used. They can disengage with the bunker's help. Johanna using the unstoppable now will be away now. Oh, Bunker is still blocking the shots from Li Ming.
and the ice block is down. She used ice block after she was out. She was dodging literally nothing. So there's, again, another opportunity to catch her way easier.
Though they are rid of Bunker and Shadowstalk. And the other hand, we have the Dragon's Arrow and the Avatar out. Let's see, turn in. They don't have enough for turn in, right? They don't. Nope, not yet. 15 missing. Sorry, what did you want to say? Sorry.
Everything fine. Right. I literally finished my sentence. I just don't know what to say anymore. This game is totally confusing for me. It makes me angry sometimes.
Sometimes angry, sometimes happy. That's beautiful.
Like the one team, like Gubba Gaming is doing so well to focus out Jaina every time, but I think they have to let her be alive, because when they push, it's when Jaina is alive and protecting, I think they will just engage on her like brute force.
The bunker there was the bunker was very important. But Lucio is there to use. Dengs are used for the disengage. Nice, Merlin's just saying. Bunker is up again. Ring is used. Rings connects on the Hanzo. Is it enough to go for damage? Leo uses the entomb. Oh, Hanzo's in trouble. Genji's banning. The Hanzo falls here. Another damage now happening here on the Leo. Leo, will he survive? He won't. Leo will fall. And there's a dead Jaina as well, but Leo is also dead as he can be. And this could be the turn in for Team Blue.
Oh, this cannot be! Like, Gubba Gaming, come on! You're the underdogs, you can win this match! It's not so
they
hard!
They stole it away again on the late fight.
This Li Ming was just so good. She used her ultimate and it got blocked out by Genji with a W from him, but she immediately stopped it. So there was no damage from it.
Damage on Johanna. Oh my god, they're brawl. 3 against 4, they're still brawl. Oh god.
But the Nestactable is still there. Like, but Genji is now stunned, can follow up.
The blue Webweaver is coming. Yeah, they should not brawl. They lost the Webweavers. It's okay. They maybe lose the force now, but they still have all structures. They don't need to force a fight here. One man down and maybe maybe throwing everything away.
I think it was a good opportunity because Leowick was there to slow them. True. And Leo stun
was
them
back, yeah.
And Blaze was not with them. He was topside to bring in the coins.
Entomb is up now.
this tombs now do? Like, what does it... This tombs, yeah. This spider tweens now do. Yeah. I don't think they will do so that's much.
Jaina is coming as well. I think... they have the silence and tomb. Whoa, they have to be careful. Oh, there's Genji on Hans on the backline. One thing is, like, why do you pick disintegrate against Genji? That's just an invitation to just deflect it. But whatever.
This is because she is confident with this. Like I said, yeah, there was a disintegrate and Genji used W and she immediately stopped it. She's not like, yeah, I will just burn my own team. That's why she picked it, because she was confident herself enough to just use it when it's the right timing.
So
like, it was the only time they tried it.
Blue web weavers are nearly gone. Just the mid four fell, but they make a play for the bottom key four as well. So. Forget a little bit more structures. Oh, they're going for the boss. They're going for the boss. Is it enough time? Nice call here. I like it.
I Blue think they saw it.
They saw that. They're moving in for this. Will it be? Will there
I
be
think
there in time?
Way too late.
They will be late.
Oh no! Lucy got stunned.
Oh my God! They will
this
be.
This will be close.
Oh God!
They tried to disinterrupt it. Interrupted Johanna at least. That is very good. Genji's now there, but not all have to stay now on the point. This is a bad time to stand
oh, no!
on the point. Like, this will be a reset party for Genji now. This will be a reset party for Genji, as he just used it to destroy them.
No.
Like, what the fuck?
No! Oh my God! Fuck!
This cannot be. There was 5 or 4 times.
Monkas, what is this? Oh no, thank you, Genji. So this might be the play for the core. They're throwing it away
this
with
has
this.
To be in a clip art.
Why,
archive,
yes,
man.
Why
this,
didn't...
Someone make a clip out of this, we need this now.
I think they should... Johanna should have moved, not Johanna, Muradin and Liwe should have moved a little bit more down and dismount them so they have a little bit more time, but no, they all got on the... oh my God. Throw the looks.
Zentomb would be enough. Zentomb would just save them. They can just block two ways. And there would this be totally enough, but now they just threw it. It was like Gubba Gaming played so good. It cannot be that they lose now.
What a delicious throw.
I feel so bad.
And then the devil is fighting by the core will fall. The core will fall. That's the ring coming. And that is that. Oh my God. They had said so much, even more lead on the first map, and they throw it again. Oh no.
That, I don't want to say it's experience because it's only one division up. Like, you literally saw that. It's popping fresh for the clip there. Like,
Thank you.
I just have to watch this again. This is ridiculous.
That was really silly. I will post this clip into the collection from Heroes Lounge, making the seasonal highlights, because it is just silly Kubik, you know. And this is a 2-0 lead victory for the Money Picks. I have to update the score, and twice they come back very late in the game with a little bit of help from Gubba Gaming, who make a strong match. They have control, they have nice ideas in their draft in both matches, and they executed it well. But they got like afraid for the last push, and then they struggled, and then they throw it away. And this is, wow. But it was, I think it was entertaining here. I like it.
Pointed now that they lost. Like, I wanted to see now third game. Like, Gubba Gaming is playing so well, but just the one thing of aggression is missing to just brute in, like to just take the spear and whip them through the enemy. And that's so sad. So much potential wasted there. It's too passive play. Too like I don't know what to say anymore.
That was just really, really fun though. And I have to say thank you for Gubba Gaming, because with the loss like this, they are sadly out of the playoffs now. They have no chance to reach the final 8 anymore from their group, which is sad, because I like their performance actually, except for the throws, though the throws were entertaining. But we will hopefully see those guys from Sweden again next season. And the Money Picks, they are still in the race for getting into the final 8 in this playoffs, in the playoffs from Division 6 and 7, called the Rare Cup. So from the Group B, Gubba Gaming is out, but three teams are still in the race. I can, let me write it here, standings. That here you can see the actual standings at the moment. So yeah. Yeah, for today, I hope you enjoyed the streaming together. It was fun, I think. Do you want to say anything to the match again? Sorry.
It's so warm and I'm completely sweating now. Like, I'm like, I'm like ailing away from my chair now. Like, especially for this whole shouting. Yeah. I just saw this X Strike Genji stuff in montages and stuff, and this funny montage videos. But the first time I experienced this to see it myself, yes. And I could cast
you
it.
You can see it coming, actually. You saw that. You said it. You said, oh my god, don't go there. The Genji will feast on that shit. But yes, they did. And you saw it. Like, they will do it again, I think. They will
like
do it again.
Morgana's just said in his mind, I shall not feed anymore.
Fancy Arisa, yes. Thank you for letting me cast. I think it was a nice cast. Fancy Arisa just said, thank you for casting. Well, so yeah. Guys, if you like this stream and you like my streaming, I would be honored if you leave me a follow so you can see my silly face again in the future, maybe, most likely. And for my co-caster, the level 13 Warlock, I hope we will hear you again as well. You can join the streams.
Really hope. Yeah. When my voice is not cracking because I'm like too much shouting.
Yeah. It was like, it's so warm here. It's really like I'm oiling like a horse.
and I have to disable my wind air.
Yes,
thing
it's too loud for the microphone.
Otherwise, it would just like
the ventilator. It's so too loud for the microphone. I think so. Yeah. Yes. It's quite early on the day still now, but there is another match today, but I am not able to stream or cast it because I'm part of the team that is playing. It will be on 21 CEST and COB anti-meta against the Asgard support. But let's see how this will turn out. For today I'm out, and yeah, do you have any last words, Mr. Warlock?
Nothing to say, I'm speechless.
Okay, yes, that's a good thing, I think.
Just play GG and we see us in the Nexus.
Yes, and Fancy Arisa, yes, I will be making a VOD out of this and I will send it to you when I upload it to YouTube, of course. I do this with all the MatchCasts. So, yeah. Thank you, everybody. Hope to see you soon. I think Sunday I will be streaming again. Tomorrow, I'm not sure yet. Leave me a follow. I would be happy with that. Of course, leave me also some feedback. I'm still new to streaming, kind of how. And if you want to see my silly face in the meantime, you can watch my newest YouTube video with a. I just put the link here. You see this? I did a Chen Ruberg first look on YouTube. You can watch that. But that is for today. See you soonish.
Bye.
Bye. So.